A very warm welcome to this, our third online conversation from St Paul's Learning. My name is Paula Gooder and I'm the Canon Chancellor here at St Paul's Cathedral, which means that I oversee the theology and learning that takes place within the life of St Paul's. In the previous two conversations, I was able to welcome you in the introduction from the cathedral itself. Unfortunately, since we're now in lockdown three, even that isn't possible. You are, nevertheless, most welcome. Today's conversation is with Bishop Sarah Mullally, the Bishop of London, and we will be reflecting on the theme of her recent Lent book, Rooted in Love, which she wrote with the area bishops from the Diocese of London. Our conversation ranges from the very personal, what it means for Bishop Sarah to feel rooted in God's love in her everyday life, all the way through to much bigger themes, like themes of vocation and its impact on our lives. We also spend a bit of time reflecting on what it feels like in dark times, when it simply does not feel like we are rooted in God's love. And we explore some practical tips of what we might do in Lent, in lockdown, to explore this theme of being rooted in love. You might like to keep your eyes open for our next conversation, which will be coming in April, and will be with the former Archbishop of Canterbury, Rowan Williams, exploring the theme of resurrection. And if you haven't, you could also have a look at our previous two conversations. The first with Timothy Radcliffe, exploring the theme of his most recent book, Alive in God, and the second with John Swinton, exploring the theme of his most recent book, Finding Jesus in the Storm, exploring mental health and Christian faith. Today, we hope that you enjoy this conversation with Bishop Sarah as much as I enjoyed having it with her. Bishop Sarah, thank you so much for joining us today. It's absolutely lovely to have you with us. Yes, and we're going to, we're talking about your book, your Lent book, Rooted in Love. Mm. And I wanted to start by you talking about that phrase, rooted in love. It's such a beautiful one, isn't it? Comes from Ephesians, that phrase, rooted and grounded in love. Can you talk to me a little bit about when you first became aware that you were rooted in love and what difference it's made to you in your life?
I became a Christian as a teenager, so had a faith at quite a young age. And I guess at that time, we're all trying to sort out our identity, who we are. You know, what are we going to do with our life? And, you know, what does God want us to do with our life? And I suppose at that point, I had a sense that, you know, the world can give us an identity, but actually the most important identity we have is that of children of God. And sort of at a young age, I did feel that the only way you know that is by being rooted in God. And then, for me, I suppose over the years, it's become that revelation that by being rooted in God, you're actually rooted in love. And it's that love that gives you your identity and your value. So in a sense, for me, it came from an early age, but there is a bit for me that I have to relearn it. It can be even easy today where you may be seeking your affirmation from the world or by what people think of you. And all of that is well and good, but actually my identity is as a child of God, rooted in his love. And that in a sense shapes how I seek to live my life.
Thank you. And I think it's a really kind of striking idea, that of being kind of deeply rooted. And the way in which the metaphor works is that it allows us to grow, doesn't it? And what I think one of the kind of the things that I find very powerful about it is that if our roots are strong, we can then grow into being a different kind of person. And have you experienced that, particularly for you, that you've been able to do things you might not have been able to do because of the rootedness that you experience?
Yeah, a sense for me, I think the question for me has always been, what is God calling me to do? What is it to follow Jesus Christ? And certainly a significant part of my life has been in a secular world. So for me, nursing was a vocation. And as a nurse, you have to face real challenging situations, difficult decisions. For me, not as many as those the nurses are facing today, oh my goodness. But you have to face those difficult decisions. And therefore the sense for me was, how do you discern what it is to be a Christian? What does it look like to follow the Christ in those situations. Now, the only way we know that is by being rooted in God, by abiding in him. Because I do believe that if we abide in him, spend time in him, we begin to, in a sense, capture his nature, understand what it is. So for me as a nurse, what was really important was developing that sense of abiding and being. And for me, I suppose the first example for me of making a difference was when I was a nurse and a sense of spending time with him. So I knew how to live my life out in those places where there are no right or wrong decisions. There are only the best decisions that you can make. So I look back actually, and for me that was a real formational part of my life as a nurse, to work out what it was also to be a Christian following Christ.
And I'm interested that you mentioned your first vocation, because one of the things I think is so interesting about your faith journey is that you have had two very, very clear vocations. Are you able to talk a little bit about what happened when you realised that one vocation was shifting and becoming a different vocation? Would you even say it like that? I think it's just a very interesting thing, was a lot of us don't have such two clear vocational tracks as you've had.
I guess I would always say I have one vocation, and that's to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. And that has therefore taken me in two very different parts, maybe different places, or not, maybe very similar places. And I suppose for me that bit about discerning that change is about how do we discern? And whether it's a big change or a little thing that we're doing, how do we discern? And I think we only discern if we've got that relationship with God. You know, we shouldn't be surprised if we spend our time in noisy, crowded places, not stopping, not abiding in God's word, not abiding in prayer. If we don't do that, we shouldn't be surprised if we can't hear the word of God and what God's calling us to do. And so for me, there is a sense in which asking God, what is it that he wants me to do? What does it look like to abide in him at that particular time? Was the journey I went on. But I have to tell you, I wouldn't, that was the hardest decision I ever made, to move from nursing into full-time into the church. You know, it was the hardest decision I have ever made. And I guess there are no right or wrong decisions. God makes the use of all of them. But actually, I think I could have only made that transition if I'd been keeping my ear close to God, if I had, if I'd been there abiding. And even today as the Bishop of London, you know, I have to remind myself that lots of people will want to say lots of things about how I do things well or not, or do things the wrong way. And a sense for me, I have to be faithful to God. And so therefore, even today, it's really important that I put aside time to read the Bible, to pray, so that I can have that growing understanding of what it is to follow God, Christ, in this moment.
I'm really struck that you mentioned, in terms of vocation, that there isn't necessarily a right and a wrong. Because I think you do get gripped, don't you, sometimes by going, well, I've got to make the right decision, and I don't know what the right decision is, and I don't even know how I'm going to make the right decision. For me, I think there's something really powerful in what you're saying about recognising that there isn't necessarily a right and a wrong discerning, but you do get that sense of pull or draw, I think, sometimes.
Yeah, I think that's right. I also think you get that sense of being unsettled. I think God unsettles us at times. You know, he sort of makes us feel uncomfortable where we are, and then we begin to question, well, should we be here? Should we be doing something different? And then, of course, there is a pull to somewhere else. So I think that's right. But I suppose over the years, I've tended to stay away from that sense, a right or wrong decision. We make a decision, and I do believe God then uses that decision, and in a sense, for us to commit that decision to God. And I think he honours that. So I have tried to stay away from right or wrong. But there is no doubt there is a pull. I also think we have to use our common sense. You know, my brother, when I was very young, could very clearly tell me I was not called to be a football player. You know, there's something about common sense. You know, God uses our skills and our abilities. And while sometimes he will bring us into places that are uncomfortable, and maybe we have to grow and develop those skills, there's something also for me about saying, God uses who we are. You know, we are, you know, that wonderful verse in Isaiah that we use at confirmations. God has called us by name and has made us his own. God has called us who we are, not despite us, but because of us. And that bit about abiding means that we can grow into the fullness of those people that he has called us to be.
Thank you. I think one of the things that you're expressing is that actually being rooted in love, knowing that vocation, does really make a difference to our everyday lives. Often when we talk about Christian faith, we kind of imagine it being on a Sunday, don't we, and what we do on a Sunday. What difference does it make for you in your everyday life that you have this strong sense of being rooted in love?
Well, I think, as I have said, you know, we are our vocation is to follow Jesus Christ, and that's wherever. And to do that, you don't have to be a priest. You know, it isn't our everyday. It's the life that we lead. So therefore, for all of us, it's really important to realise we all have that vocation. And I guess for me, over the years, I've developed, I suppose, different ways. I mean, you know, I always think there's that, you know, I was very grateful for prayer. You know, there's the prayer that we pray very on a routine basis. We have a rhythm of life. We set aside time, but also on that moment. So I'm very conscious, you know, if I was going to break bad news to a patient as a nurse, or if it, you know, in the Department of Health, I was going to a very difficult meeting, or even now, if I'm going to lead a service, or if I'm going to meet, you know, groups of clergy, I will pray just before I go into that. And just ask that for me to have an awareness of God and of his love. And I think that's shaped my everyday life. I also think if I can see myself as being rooted in God, in love, if I can see myself as a child beloved of God, then actually it's shaped how I see everybody else. You know, because everybody else is a child beloved of God. And therefore, it should shape the way I treat them. To see them in God's image. So that, I think, has shaped me as well in my everyday, how I encounter people, how I treat them, value them, treat them with kindness.
Thank you. I think the harsh reality at the moment is all of our everydays are now completely different, aren't they? They're not as they were. And many of us, I think, particularly during this third lockdown, are finding ourselves facing really, really tough times. Have you got any wisdom to offer about how you live a life rooted in love in these really tough times?
Well, I think it has been tough. I think all of us, because of lockdown, have found ourselves in a different space. Now, that space may sometimes have felt empty. Sometimes it may have felt overwhelmed and full. And so I think there's always an important place where we should stop and say, you know, reflect on what is the rhythm of my life? Am I praying enough? Am I reading the Bible enough? You know, how could we change our routine to ensure that we take care first and foremost of our relationship with God? You know, for me, at the very beginning, I had a very different shape. And for the first time, probably in all my married life, my husband and I were at the same place at 8 o'clock in the morning. So in fact, we have been saying morning prayer at 8 o'clock each morning together, which has been a real difference. So for me, that rhythm has really benefited me. But as life has got busier and life has become much more full of Zoom, I have had to keep that discipline because it could be very easily crowded out. I also think for us, you know, we may not be in those places where we'd normally pray or find God. So for me, I love the countryside. I love walking. I can't do any of that at the moment. You know, we're locked down. Whilst I walk around the city, it's not quite the same as walking out in the countryside. So I recognise in me that space is gone. So, for example, in my courtyard, in my backyard, I purposely will have my coffee and my tea out there because it's a moment for me to catch a handkerchief of sky, maybe see the blackbird or the robin, and think of God's creation. So I've also recognised that because things have been taken away where I normally find closeness with God, I need to put those back in. But you only do that if you take a moment, look back on what you've been doing and say, how do I reflect in God's presence, whether I've got quite that routine of prayer, Bible study, right?
And are there any particular techniques that you find particularly helpful? Your mentioning of the looking back reminds me of the Ignatian Examen, where you spend a bit of time at the end of the day reflecting on what brings you life and what has diminished your life. Are there any particular techniques that you find helpful to do this?
Well, for me, that would be one of them. So in a very basic form. So I would do that at the end of the day. But I also some of those Ignatius techniques of just focusing on something, whether it's the robin in the back garden or the crocuses that are beginning to come in, and to begin to try and see in things that maybe you pass over something more of God. So I would do that. But also for me, one of the, I suppose one of those things that have really given me life has been compline. The use of compline in the evening, not least to settle the anxieties of the day, but it has such a richness of stillness and quietness. So for me, compline has been a very particular part of my spirituality over the last 10 months.
Yeah, no, I love the service of compline as well. I love the ritual of lighting the candle and sitting with my husband and praying. It's an important one, isn't it?
It is, yeah. It's been great.
What we've been talking about so far in our conversation is your own personal experience of being rooted in love and what a difference it's made to your life and the ways in which that's changed things for you. And I think one of the things that we often find quite hard to do is to talk to other people about our experiences. You're very articulate in doing it. But I think many of us feel kind of slightly nervous about talking to people about our experiences of being rooted in love. Are there any tips that you would offer people about how they become much more confident in talking about their experience of love and of God and of their faith?
Well, one of the things I've learned is that people come to faith not through, not through big strategies or organisational plans, but through personal encounters. And therefore, it's important for us to build personal encounters with people and relationships where people, you can just chat naturally to people about everything. And then the second thing I've learned is people love other people's stories. You know, I love to hear people's stories, whatever they're about. So people love stories. So actually to talk about your faith or to talk about the love that we found in God, to talk about how Jesus impacts in our lives are about stories. And so therefore there's something about thinking about stories, and often we're good at telling that, stories about how, for example, our trip to the dump went, or, so why not practice some of our stories about the difference our faith has made? And it may be as simple, it's as simple as saying, actually, through this difficult time, I have found reading the Bible to give me strength, or actually my church congregation has on every Sunday, even when we've been online, has been able to hold me during an anxious period. So there's something about realizing people love stories. And as long as you're talking about your story, people generally respect that. So maybe there's something about practicing our stories with one another. And one of the, I suppose, the glimpses I've had as I've gone around churches on Zoom is that actually people are telling those stories on Zoom in maybe ways they wouldn't have done in church, in front of the church, in a church building. So maybe Zoom as well is an opportunity for us to practice our stories with each other. So just telling people the story of how God has helped us in that week, maybe how it's been a comfort to us, and then having practiced it with each other, practice it with maybe our friends who aren't Christians.
So I'm going to be mean now, Bishop Sarah, since you've been talking about telling your story, I'm going to ask you to do it. And see is there something that you can tell us about maybe an experience from when you were nursing or from when you were younger, a story in which you felt so held in love that the world changed for you?
Well, I would think, I share my story over the last 10 months, really. I think, over the last 10 months, there have been times where I personally have felt anxious and afraid. There are times when I have also struggled with what I have seen on the television or heard from my friends about what's happening in the National Health Service. And I think for me, my relationship with God, the fact that there has been somebody I can always go to and share that emotionally, has held me firm and secure in the moment. So it hasn't meant that my fear has necessarily gone away. It hasn't meant that actually conditions have necessarily got easier in the National Health Service, but it has meant that I felt God holding me in this present. And so for me, that has been very formative over the last 10 months for me personally.
Bishop Sarah, we're talking about being rooted in love. Is there a particular Bible verse that for you expresses that?
Well, actually, there's quite a few, really. But I suppose the one I always come back to is John 15, that has that wonderful image of the vine. And this sense, you know, abide is mentioned time and time again in that passage. And it's this wonderful image of a vine that has to be rooted. And so I do come back to that. And one of the wonderful things about that passage, it doesn't just talk about, you know, abiding in God and in Jesus. It doesn't talk just about being rooted in God, but it talks about love very specifically, about being rooted and abiding in love. And it gives this wonderful image of this sort of vine that overlaps and intertwines. And in a sense, for me, it partly describes my life, really, my Christian life, as, you know, wound around other people and being interrelated to other people. But at the heart of it is that sense of being rooted in God, abiding in Jesus Christ. And for me, it's only then that actually love comes out and love can be there. If I know the love of God, if I know his love represented in Jesus Christ, then it's that over, in a sense, wells up in me, and I have the ability to love other people. So it's the vine in John 15.
It's really lovely hearing you talking about your experiences of being rooted in love. And it's very striking how that seam runs through your life so strongly. But there are some people, and there are certainly some times in our lives when actually it just doesn't feel that way, does it? You just don't feel rooted in love. What would you say to people if they're sitting here listening to us have the conversation saying, yes, but it just doesn't feel like I'm rooted in love?
Oh, gosh, yes. I mean, I could tell you times when I have found myself almost in that barren land, that wilderness where, I may even be struggling, I may be struggling to notice the love of God, but I may be even struggling to notice God. And I think all of us go through those times, and I think there'd be a very unusual person that hasn't. For me, I think the lesson has been that if we have some sort of spiritual routine to our life, and that may vary, you know, it may be a Bible study in the morning, it may be morning and evening prayer. But I think if we have a routine, when we get to those wilderness moments, that I do believe that routine will hold us. And that routine will hold us to the point at which maybe we just catch that blossom in evening prayer or in compline that just captures us again. So I would encourage people to establish a routine in the good times, so that when you hit those difficult times, you can just keep going. It sustains you, but also almost there's that sense that when you're in those moments, you may just capture something of that flower in the wilderness, you know, the water in the desert when you need it, that then begins to enable you to flourish and grow again. But being in those difficult places, I think, is very normal for Christians. And there's something about us, how we establish that routine, so that actually when time is tough, we may just suddenly recapture that moment, but also use other people, speak to other people, use them to support you, prayer, people to pray for you. So also use the company of all the saints as well.
Yes, absolutely. And I love that. I remember when I was going through a very dark patch, my spiritual director quoted the lovely Iona hymn, "I will hold the Christ light for you." Yeah, and it was really powerful for me to know that actually it didn't have to be me, that somebody else could do it on my behalf, and that actually if they persevered for me, and it kind of kept me going.
Yes, and I also, for me, having been in a cathedral, that sense that there are people praying morning and evening, whether it's monastic communities or whether it's cathedral communities. So even though those difficult times, the sense that people are praying for us, even if we're not known by them, they will be praying for us. And that, for me, yes, that's a wonderful image of somebody else holding the Christ-like light for us.
Yeah. And again, I love that sense when I'm in the cathedral praying, that I am praying on behalf of everybody else. And that even if I've never met them, I am in some way praying for them, which is a lovely image, isn't it?
It is.
One of the things I want to do now is just to look forward a little bit, because in a sense, it feels as though when we are thinking about COVID and the pandemic, we're kind of very much rooted in now. Do you have hopes for the church in the future? Do you have hopes for the life of Christians in the Diocese of London and across the country? What, as we emerge out of lockdown and the pandemic time, which sincerely hope we will eventually. There's going to be quite a lot of rebuilding to do, isn't there? What do you hope will have changed for us all as we do that?
Well, I think one of the wonderful privileges of being the Bishop of London is that I get to see all the good things that are going on, even in these difficult times. So in a sense, my hope for the future starts in the present. You know, in these difficult moments, I've seen Christians and churches step up and step out into their communities. And so they have shown God's love to people in very practical ways, whether it's food banks, whether it's all those wonderful Christmas hampers that were delivered, you know, whether it's just befriending people, reducing loneliness by picking up telephones. They've shown the love of God in very practical ways. I've also seen hope in the way that churches have responded in very specific ways to whether they remain in their church buildings or whether they go online. They have kept their communities safe and they have provided comfort and hope in worshipping. And I have seen that hope. And so in a sense, the hope I see today is the hope that I see going forward, because I know that Christians have been growing in their faith confidently, they've been loving their communities, and actually we are seeing churches grow. So that for me is the hope. And I suppose building on that, I hope that they find time together to reflect on the way in which God has been moving in their community. How has the Spirit been moving? And therefore, what is God telling them about their community going forward? What is God calling them to do as they begin to move forward in a sort of not, I don't think it will ever be a post-COVID world, because I suspect it's going to be around for us for much longer. But there's something about what has God been teaching us here that he's calling us to do more of in the coming months and years.
And that feels like a very Lenten theme, doesn't it? As this goes out and we're about to start Lent, do you have any tips for people as they're facing this Lent this year of what kinds of things they might want to do in order to be able to reflect, as you've been suggesting?
And so I think there are some things to learn from the last lockdown about how we begin to develop a routine in our lives. How do we, you know, it's not just about giving things up, but how do we take up a routine, which is about being in God's presence, reflecting on him and allowing him to reflect on us. So I think that's the first thing. The second thing is that where is our church community? How can we do it with our church community? Recognizing that lockdown still exists. What have we learned from the last 10 months that we could reimagine into lockdown? So how could we do it together going forward? And I would encourage people to take up a resource. Obviously, we produce Rooted in Love, which is around a Lent book. It is our offer to the Diocese of London and to the clergy of the diocese. It may be something that people will want to take forward in Lent. It is written in that way. We've written it as an offering, and maybe using it as a way of reflecting and beginning to grow deeper and rooting ourselves in God during that period of time.
So with perfect timing, you mentioned the book as I was about to ask you about it. Just tell us a little bit more about it. What's its shape? How will people encounter it? And what do you really hope they'll take away? I think we probably know that already, but we'll do that at the end. What do you hope people will take away from the book? But tell us a little bit more about the shape of the book and what it's like.
Well, the book itself began some time ago, probably well over 18 months ago, as we were beginning to ask people in the Diocese of London of what they had discerned God doing, what they thought God was calling us to do. And we asked over 6,000 people in the church, outside the church, about what they saw God doing and what we should be doing more of. And there were some very clear messages that came through. So we have this wonderful vision of being there for every Londoner. But also we began to see three priorities: to grow in discipleship, to grow in our compassion for our communities, and to creatively grow as a church. And I suppose as a College of Bishops here in London, we began to focus on the first one. How could we grow in depth in our discipleship in terms of following the Lord Jesus Christ? How could we grow in the love of God? Because there is a sense in which from that rootedness in God grows forth our compassion, comes forth the growth that God offers us as a church. And so as a college of bishops, we decided that we would work on this book together and develop this book. So the book itself is a contribution from the College of Bishops in London. Each one of us have authored a different chapter, and then we brought it all together. So that's what the book is. It's a book really offering us an opportunity to grow in our rootedness in God. Each chapter has a reflection. It then has an action that's suggesting of what we could do, and it has a prayer. So we could do the journey either individually, or maybe we could do the journey in a group.
Bishop Sarah, it's been absolutely lovely talking to you today, and thank you so much for joining us.
No, thank you, Paula.